made the right decision.
He's from Nani.
What are they going to make of me?
He's not very experienced at handling this kind of group of people.
This week we've been learning to do a dance.
I've had a bit more flack about the service on Sunday.
Can you imagine anybody being quite so stupid?
Can the new rector break old habits? A Country Parish. A brand new series begins Tuesday at 8 on BBC Two.
We laugh. We cried. We held our breath. And revenge was sweet.
Beautiful! Beckham has scored for England!
What were you talking about in 2002?
Will!
What's the matter, Trevor? Cat got your tongue?
Millions of us watch, and now it's your chance to vote for your golden TV moments of 2002. Join me, Jonathan Ross, and the stars for the award ceremony that belongs to you.
2002 TV Moments, Saturday at 9 on BBC One.
Did my hair look okay now? Just so we get so many complaints.
Policing Britain's railways, BBC One's Right on Track with the Rail Cops in half an hour. Don't be a sucker first on BBC One. Get results with Watchdog.
A Dyson vacuum cleaner cost £200. But from this credit store, it could cost you £520. How bright is shopping at Brighthouse?
And the Motorway calf cake, that's well art.
And flood alert. Another visit to the Dolphin bathroom. Watchdog, your money, your show. Hello, welcome to Watchdog. We're live from the office where we're still bailing out the flood of emails from you about two of the companies featured last week for leaving customers in the lurch.
We'll look at the Dolphin bathroom deluge and the lastminute.com torrent shortly, but first, a quick quiz.
Oh, good.
What do all these areas have in common? Birkenhead, Bootle, Biker.
Castlemilk, Clydebank, Corby, Partick, Pollock, Peckham.
Wallsend, Walthamstow and West Brom.
Well, they're all areas of high unemployment and low income. It's no coincidence these areas and 100 others like them throughout the country have all got a Brighthouse store. Brighthouse, or the credit outlet a lot of people turn to buy basic household goods. Here's a PlayStation, advertised for only £5.99 a week. Pay that for a year and a half, and it's yours to keep. By that time, of course, you've stumped up £450, up to three times its price in some shops. Brighthouse called their credit deals the bright and affordable choice for your home. Some of the families Paul Heine's been to see have got another name for it.
When you haven't got much in your pocket, the high street can be a lonely place. Certainly the banks won't be very keen to lend you anything. But there is one place that will be pleased to see you. It's called Brighthouse, and they really want to be your friend, providing you are prepared to enter into a long-term relationship.
Meet the Scamp family from Liverpool. They've run up devastating debts with Brighthouse that they'll be paying off for 3 years. That's because, not being able to get credit elsewhere, they furnish their house almost entirely with goods from Brighthouse, which offers, according to the brochure that came through the Scamp's door, affordable shopping for a brighter home. Come in for a chat and a cup of coffee with our trained and friendly staff. That's what they said, and so he did.
How did you get involved with Brighthouse in the first place?
We did need a washing machine. A very essential item with a family. This is the washing machine.
That was the first thing you
got
from them?
That's the very first thing I ever got from them, yes.
The cash price for this second-hand washing machine was £421.54, costing Tony £6.59 a week over 3 years. That adds up to £1,028. But what else is he paying for? Well, there's the APR at 29.9%, and the real sting in the tail, the service and insurance cover, costing as much as the machine itself.
What came next?
The TV and video.
Tony bought other items from Brighthouse, taking his instalments to nearly £30 a week. His total debt? Nearly £4,500, almost twice as much as if he'd paid cash. Realising he was in difficulty, Brighthouse rewrote the contract, giving the scamps free service cover, which, they say, amounts to £1,500. Nevertheless, Tony was clearly at his limit.
So, what do you think Brighthouse do about that? Do they say, hang on, Tony, you've perhaps borrowed too much. Can we help you in some way? You ought to stop.
No,
what
no.
do they do?
They offered me a second-hand three-piece suite, three-seater, two-seater sofa, £400 in the store.
Again, he got into difficulty. So now it was time for Brighthouse's friendly service team to swing into action.
So, Tony, who was it on your doorstep?
Representatives from Brighthouse.
What did they want?
The goods back.
John Battle is the MP for Leeds West. There's a Brighthouse store in the heart of his constituency. He says it's there to deliberately target those who are less well off. He's now calling for changes in the law to govern such lenders.
Companies like Brighthouse that may seem to be offering good cheap deals, in fact, because they charge such an exorbitant amount of interest, are locking the poor into debt. In effect, I would argue that they're really leeching off the lifeblood of the poor, forcing them into deep debt for the rest of their lives. It's unsustainable debt. And I think what's more, because they are part of the larger banking system, and often reputable companies, and what they're doing is not illegal, in effect, our credit cards are at the expense of the poorest, because they're being subsidised by those who are forced to pay the highest rates.
Getting into debt with a company like Brighthouse can be a worrying experience, but one customer found it terrifying. When she fell behind on the repayments for a bed and a stereo, one of the Brighthouse boys was soon at her door.
My child's in that house and this person's out there threatening to kick the door down. I said, you're not coming in my home, and then he was getting really angry as he was talking, he was raising his voice, and as that he smacked his hand against his van. So I came back inside, and at that point I was really panicking. At first I was like, I can't move, and by that time the police have pulled up outside.
The debt collector was given some advice by the police. By chance, this happened on the same day Brighthouse were looking to recruit further arrears control staff. They advertised for an intelligent, customer-focused individual. Someone like this, perhaps?
I didn't do anything.
Oh, did?
Yeah, well, that's why I want to come and get it. Because if comes, he'll have the same again.
She was shocked by the actions of the Brighthouse employee. Another Brighthouse worker was so disturbed by what he was being asked to do, he resigned and spoke to us.
It was almost bullying. That's how I felt. Just badger them until they paid up. It was literally how we worked in many cases.
This was hinted at when we visited Brighthouse undercover to inquire about a stereo.
What you need to do is make sure that you can make these payments before you sign them up.
Yeah.
Because the gentleman in the office there will batter you with phone calls if you go late at all. So they do ring you up, yes, and we letter you, and we do, you know, so.
And the man who'll be doing the phone battering and lettering is this man.
The biggest killer is the late fees.
That's...
Once you're in that spiral of dropping late, coming in on the Monday and trying to find the late fees, it's a vicious circle.
I came across one case where one person, every single week, she was paying a small amount, I think it was about £3 a week, but every week, because she was late, she'd pay a £2 late fee every single week. So she was paying £5 a week on a £3 a week payment. Quite a substantial amount of the income in one branch that I came across was actually late fees.
Most people think there's an attractive offer, but they don't realise what they're getting into for the long term. And then really, once they've made the commitment, they're then hounded, sometimes for years, to pay back at absolutely exorbitant rates of interest.
Well, in a statement, Brighthouse says it believes everyone should have the opportunity to own what it calls the nice things in life. It rejects the claim that late fees constitute a vicious circle for customers. It says its new rate of £2.50 for late fees is by far the lowest we're aware of in the credit industry.
It utterly rejects the accusation of using bully boy tactics to get people to pay. It says all staff dealing with debt are, quote, highly trained, tightly controlled and regularly audited, and that all their procedures have been thoroughly discussed with the regulators and are fully written up in their training and operational manuals. Well, we heard John Battle, the MP, talking about exorbitant interest rates. Those exorbitant interest rates obviously take into account all the other charges. But Dave Nellist is here, who's a debt counsellor, used to be an MP, of course, many people will remember that. A lot of people in this country, I think it's nearly 8 million, are excluded from mainstream credit. So you can see why this is so tempting.
And Brighthouse's advisors actually put their stores in what they call economically challenged areas. You're right, the last estimates in December were of 7.8 million. That's one in every five adults who can't get a bank account, can't get more normal credit arrangements, and therefore pushed into arms of what is actually a multi-billion dollar business, of which Brighthouse is one prime example.
Yeah, businesses not dissimilar to this in other parts of Europe have actually been made illegal. So do you think this is actually something that some of your former friends and colleagues in the House of Commons should be getting their teeth into?
Brighthouse had to leave France in the 1990s. Places like Germany and Switzerland only 4 weeks ago have capped the maximum interest that consumer credit agreements can be set at. In Switzerland's case, it's 15%. That's many times less than what Brighthouse gets away with. Yes, I think the government ought to take this industry by the...
Whatever, I know what you think.
I was trying to think of something that the lawyers wouldn't object to.
Exactly,
you see, that was my problem.
I was totally worried about what you were going to come up with, but we know exactly what you mean. Yeah. But there's a whole generation, just finally, a whole generation, Dave, of parents out there, and you can hear them saying, look, if you ain't got the money, don't buy the stuff.
Well, there are alternatives. There used to be, through the benefits system, a system of grants that unfortunately went, and more people pushed in this direction. For about a third of a million people already, there are credit unions set up in most major cities and towns. And these are organisations that lend to people on a community basis, and I'd heartily recommend them.
OK, thanks for doing that. Dave Nellist, thanks for your time. OK.
Now, that dolphin deluge. Last week, we highlighted three families who, between them, spent nearly £25,000 on dolphin bathrooms, which were either shoddily finished or not finished at all.
Yep. Some of you felt that the dolphin advertising claim, we take care of absolutely everything, deserved its own bathroom accessory.
A special flannel award.
Yeah, handles... Water closet music.
Does it send you around the U-bend?
Log off. Now, Kate's been wading through the second wave of disenchanted dolphin customers. Watch this.
What you got there, Cos?
Oh, there's masses coming in. There's dolphin.
Got one here, and they started fitting the bathroom in December 2001. It's still not finished.
Over a year.
Yeah. Whoa. Got a couple here from Surrey whose radiators were fitted upside down.
The one here, Sheffield, still no shower that works, and they all started in July last year.
Subcontractor here was previously working in a circus in Russia. That's a lady in the Wirral.
She did tell me that she was a trained gymnast in a travelling circus.
You agree to pay thousands of pounds for a fabulous premier bathroom, and in fact the fitter told me he was actually a chef.
On the first day the fitter turned up. He turned up in a minicab. He had less tools than I have, and I actually can't stand DIY.
The work started on December 18th, 2001, and after 2 days effective work, the fitter left us without any toilet for 6 days over Christmas.
It has now been a year and a half, and as you can see, we still have no shower. They are ripping it out again.
Upstairs, we now have to have the whole shower room rebuilt because it was so badly done in the first place.
My wife gave birth to our daughter 6 weeks premature. She came home to a house with no bath, no sink, and she had to resort to washing our newborn baby downstairs in the kitchen.
I just want dolphin bathrooms out of my bathroom and out of my life.
Customers whose dreams of a glorious dolphin bathroom have all gone down the plug hole. But Watchdog has received some other interesting emails from people on the front line, past and present, with dolphin.
We met them at a secret location so they could tell us more about life under dolphin. The designer. He didn't only design, he also plugged dolphins' bathrooms to customers. But last week's Watchdog meant he'd seen one bathroom plug too many. the fitter. He's been a builder for 20 years, but for several months as a Dolphin subcontractor, he put in bathrooms. Now he wants to put in the boot. The fixer. He also worked as a Dolphin subcontractor, not only fitting, but fixing the botched bathrooms.
Yeah. What's gone wrong with Dolphin bathrooms?
I think it all stems from head office. Reason being, the surveyor gets it wrong, the designer gets it wrong. Now, when they get it wrong, we're going to get it wrong. You know, it's a total shambles.
The Dolphin Bathrooms brochure says we are now the recognised experts in fully fitted bathrooms and our expert installers bring your new bathroom to life.
It takes 2 days to become a qualified fitter of Dolphin bathrooms. On the plumbing side of it, you get asked 10 basic questions which someone would know at home. If you can answer them questions, they'll sign you straight on.
Draw a picture. That's all it was. About
the
majority of the people in that class got it wrong anyway.
Yeah, asking the
but they were still accepted.
But what about Dolphin's designers?
It only takes 5 days for Dolphin to educate you to be an expert designer.
Only 5 days?
Only 5 days.
What kind of people are signing up?
To me, any kind of person can be a Dolphin designer. That means policemen, truck drivers, anything. You don't need to have any kind of skill or education. And they don't take any reference on you.
Dolphin often demand a particular commitment from their customer before they've even started the job.
I've never, ever come across anyone charging the full amount at the beginning of the job when the job hasn't even started.
Is that what Dolphin did?
That's what Dolphin do. Yeah, before we even get our tools off the van, customer has paid the full amount for the bathroom.
In 1998, the Office of Fair Trading threatened legal action against the group that owned Dolphin, until they dropped a clause in their contracts asking customers to pay in full up front.
The real beauty of a Dolphin bathroom is the service.
Dolphin is proud of installing 10,000 bathrooms a year, but the number of customer complaints Watchdog has received suggests it's selling some bathrooms better than it's been fitting them.
Dolphins say they've been through a 2-year period of rapid growth, as a result of which they say they're acutely aware that they haven't always delivered the highest standards of service. Because of this, Dolphin's operations have been totally reorganized. It's released many fitters and replaced them with more rigorously trained ones. And it says the designs of all bathrooms are checked by fully qualified and highly trained technical surveyors before they're fitted.
Now, more than a few of you have been giving us food for thought about food you didn't want to think about. The food you get at some motorway service stations. To see for ourselves, we sent a camera crew on tour with a peckish Ashley Blake.
Road for hours, and Swindon seems further away than you'd like to think about. You're tired, hungry, and you really need the loo. And then you get a sign, the answer to your prayers. Until that is, reality bites.
As a rule, it was the service is bad, the place looks like a mess, horrifically overpriced.
Understaffed, the food's not very good.
It's never hot, it's just either tasteless or greasy.
The chips were like cold. The pie wasn't too bad, but it pun dawdling, it's a joke.
They're expensive, the food's appalling, and I'd rather hold it.
Over the last week, the Watchdog team has been out on the road sampling some of the highs and the lows of the UK's motorway services. And what we found are scenes which some of you may find disturbing.
Our mission was simple, to cover as many miles of motorway as possible, inspecting the bathrooms and food of each and every services we passed along the way. Our findings were varied. Almost all the women's loos were immaculate. The men's toilets, however, were slightly more hit and miss. Like these urinals at Moto's Birch Services. And you really don't want us to show you what we found in the cubicles at First Motorway's Bolton West facilities. Or Road Chef's Bolsover services. And if you're hoping to freshen up with a nice hot shower, don't bank on it. This particular Road Chef have found an alternative use for their shower room as a store cupboard. And as for the ones at First Motorway's Bolton West site, With all that water on the floor, you might mistake this for a shower room. But these are actually the baby changing facilities at Welcome Breaks Leicester Forest East site.
Okay, so most of us can cope with the odd dodgy toilet or shower, as long as there's something decent to eat. Or at least half decent. Or even just, well, edible. It seems, though, some services struggle to provide even that.
We started with something simple.
Can I get a jacket potato with beans, please?
This is the Northampton Road Chef's idea of a baked potato and beans. £3.49 to us. Further down the road, we came to another Road Chef establishment, their Watford Gap services.
Hiya, I'm still trying to decide.
The staff there offered to lovingly restore a plate of chili con carne for us.
What did you just say?
Skin on top of the hot ones.
We declined her kind offer and moved on. Little did we know that things were only going to get worse. Further up the M1 at Donington Park, we had our first encounter with a plate of Moto chicken and roasted vegetables. That was once a carrot, and that's supposed to be a courgette. Although they looked and smelt historical, that didn't stop Moto from charging a very contemporary £6.99. Meanwhile, at the trial Moto services, the management have thought of everything. They've even provided a contemplation room for private prayer, reflection, and peace and quiet. Pity it wasn't open, because we felt the need to reflect on this piece of coffee and walnut cake. We couldn't get into it either. But hold that image, because it was a spookily similar story at Welcome Breaks Warwick services.
And then the saga of the roasted vegetables returned to haunt us.
At the Moto Lancaster services, we were served this plate of pie, baked potato, and roasted vegetables. But then we spotted this notice. If you're not completely satisfied with the quality of your meal, we'll replace it or give you a full refund.
Yes. Well, I mean, would you eat it?
Right, no, I agree. Can I give you a refund or would you like something else?
Later on, with our £6.49 returned but still hungry, we tried a safer option, a nice cheese salad from Moto of Knutsford. But the grated carrot was so old it was brown and shriveled around the edges, and the cheese had been on display long enough to dry out and turn rubbery. And we paid £5.99 for this. Once again, the staff gave us a refund when we complained, but once again, they gave us a less than glowing review of their own meal.
I mean, you wouldn't eat that, would you?
Oh, no.
We did experience friendly and helpful service from all the companies in our road test, but the award for honesty has to go to Moto, the motorway services that dishes up food even its own staff wouldn't eat.
Well, Moto admit they don't always get it right. That's why they have that no-quibble money-back guarantee. But they say they're committed to addressing each of the points raised in our report.
Welcome Break are deeply disappointed at what Watchdog found, but say if some of our standards are below par, we have to work diligently on improving them.
And First Motorway Services Limited say they're sorry that on the day we visited, their standards weren't what they aimed to achieve. They assure customers their focus will continue to be on quality.
John Greenwood from Road Chef joins us. Hiya, John. But it was good of your lady there to offer to de-skin the chili con carne. Credit where credit's due.
Indeed, thank you. Clearly, we're disappointed with your findings. We're really on a mission at Road Chef to improve the standards of everything we do. This last 2 years, we've invested £30 million in our estate to upgrade it. We've quadrupled our training budgets. We've put more than £1.5 million more into management and supervision.
So you're on an upward road.
Absolutely.
The thing is, I mean, stopping at these places, if you've got kids in the back of the car, everyone will know it's very often an absolute necessity. And it's often dire. It should and it could be a pleasure.
Yes, well, I don't agree with you that it's often dire. In fact, through our breakfast and lunch service, which is 70% of our trade, I think we are good, if not very good. It's unfortunate that on the shoulder periods, in the afternoon and the evening, food can be left lying around too long, and that's the real reason why you found, I believe, some of the things you found.
Why is it so difficult keeping food fresh?
Well, sometimes it's the choice of product that's left lying too long under the lights and it dries out, like the chili con carne. And we'll be looking at that because it shouldn't be there. In other cases, it's simply that there aren't enough customers to buy the food, but they do want it.
The two of us here could be onto something. There aren't enough customers, because interestingly, 95% of people who roll up and down our motorways don't even use these places. But if you made the food better and made it fresher and made the facilities even better, more people would use them. So you get more business, up the quality, more customers.
Absolutely, and everybody in the industry knows that's true. Everyone knows that that's where we can improve our own company's performances. And we're all on a mission to do that. It's not an easy business to run, though. You know, you can have 500 people 1 minute, five the next. And the peaks and troughs are very difficult to cater for, especially when everybody wants food right away. And we have to get a balance between leaving food on the counter and producing food fresh to order.
Thanks for coming in. It's more than the others did. Cheers, John.
Thank you.
Now, new from Argos, the now you see it, now you don't, half-price Minolta Dimage 7i digital camera. Many of you saw it in the newspaper ads for the Argos sale. Problem is, you couldn't find it in the store when you got there. To get the picture, Nikki joined the last of the sales queues.
January, and the streets are full of eager bargain hunters jostling to buy all the stuff that nobody wanted before Christmas. And why?
Of course, there are always a few genuine bargains among last year's seconds, but you have to move pretty fast if you want to nab yourself a real deal.
Daryl McGee thought he'd beaten the rush when he decided to take advantage of the pre-Christmas sales at Argos.
He was hoping he'd get to capture those special Christmas moments on this half-price Minolta digital camera.
When I seen the Minolta, I was sort of really pleased, because I'd actually been looking for that camera before but couldn't justify nearly £900 for a camera. So as soon as I saw it, that was it.
Daryl called the Argos ring and reserve line only to be told
this item is out of stock at present. However, please try again later.
With the Argos website, you can actually do a stock check on each of their individual branches. So I went on the net and tried Bridgewater and Taunton, and they never had any again. I tried Devon, Cornwall, along the safe coast. I think I stopped at Brighton, then I started working up towards the Midlands and just got pretty bored by the time I got to Birmingham, I think it was.
So no early Christmas present for Daryl, but that didn't stop Argos from advertising the same camera again in their January sale catalogue.
I've been looking for this particular camera for a couple of months, so I was really pleased when I saw it on the site, thought this has got to be an offer I can't miss.
But it was £150 more than it had been before Christmas. And was it available this time?
I decided to be there when the stores opened. So I asked a member of staff. He first checked the local stock, and then he checked what he said was the national stock. None available whatsoever.
The Minolta wasn't the only camera that was hard to come by.
There were two cameras I was interested in. One was the Canon Ixus, and the other one was a Sony, both advertised at being half price. But this was the first day of the sale. There was no stock available, which I thought was a bit strange, considering the sale runs until the 17th of January. I thought, well, perhaps the stock isn't in yet, so I continued to check on a daily basis for about a week or so, until suddenly I came to the conclusion that they were never going to have any stock in.
Say unprecedented demand for the cameras following the advert in the national press meant stocks quickly ran out. They say demand went berserk, but the trio in our film needn't, because Argos are sending each a free digital camera.
Crash bang, what a picture. What a result.
Remember, you can email us via the website www.bbc.co.uk/watchdog, call us at National Race on 0870 010 7070, or write to us at Watchdog, BBC TV, London W12 7TS.
And scores of you bombarded us with more complaints about lastminute.com. Last Tuesday, head honcho Martha Lane Fox told us Christmas period ticketing problems affected only a tiny fraction of their customers and they'd all been refunded. We'd no reason to doubt her.
We do now. droves of you have since told us you've had the same problems of double charging and long-running battles for refunds. The message from all of you to lastminute.com is blunt.
Pull your finger out and give us our money back.
Now, after last week's debate about when, in household insurance terms, a bird may or may not be counted an animal, we've hatched more zoological dilemmas. Ian Durbridge from Sheffield says one of these little fellas, a sparrow, flew down his chimney and proceeded to redecorate the furniture in a variety of colours.
Yeah. Ian's claim to direct line was turned down on the policy grounds that birds are classed as vermin. Vermin? Your common sparrow, as was, is now so relatively uncommon, it's heading for endangered species status, zoologically. It's practically a late sparrow, Kate.
Thank you, Nikki. Wildlife on one, Campbell. We're pleased to report Direct Line now say they will pay out on Ian's policy and are reviewing the definition of vermin.
Yeah. So, David Attenborough, your job is safe. We're back next Tuesday at 7. EastEnders is coming next. Thanks for watching. Keep in touch with us for all your stories from all of us here at Watchdog. Good night.
Good night. So you.
It's almost time for a new day to begin.
There's a situation, Mr. President.
How serious?
Very.
NSA wants us to bring in Jack Bauer.
If a bomb goes off today, it will hurt us, but it will destroy you.
I will hurt you.
I refuse to believe they can't bring in one former agent.
Coming soon.
Today's going to be a very long day.
24 returns to BBC Two.
How does a family cope with the murder of a child by a close relative? Missing Danielle, the family story, here on BBC One in 40 minutes. It's a job on the line first on BBC One with some strong language and you